Good afternoon to everyone. We welcome you to this fresh episode of the Property Show. On our panel today are Mr. Suresh Hari. He is chairman of Credai Bangalore. Rajesh Joshi. He is CEO Residential Brigade Group. Rohan Sharma. He is research head Cushman & Wakefield. Mr. Swarup Banish. He is executive director Prestige Group. Akshay Diwani. He is CEO Residential Assets Group. Surbhi Arora. Head Research Magic Bricks. The session will be moderated by E. Jayashri Kurup. She is the editor-in-chief of MBTV. Over to you, Jayashri, now.
Thanks, Deepak. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. The Property Show is where we actually track the trends across the country, and we try to find the ins and outs of why things are the ground reality, why that happened and how it happened. And I'm going to start with the Prop Index. The Magic Bricks Prop Index is a document that we mine the data on the Magic Bricks. It's big data. And we come up with, we index it to different cities and we figure out what's happening in the country. Now, Surbhi has come up with a new edition of the Prop Index. And remember, this April to June quarter is entirely in the lockdown. Right? It is after the pandemic. So it gives you a fair idea of how we moved through the pandemic. So Deepak, could we have the next slide, please? Yeah. Surbhi, if you would like to take people, we've got a graph up there which shows how the entire consumer sentiment moved through the pandemic. So would you like to tell us how this moved?
Yeah, sure, Jayashri. Thank you. So we would all agree that April to June was an extraordinary quarter, and there was a strict restriction on movement across cities. So if you see the graph, naturally, the real estate has taken a momentary halt soon after India announced or implemented the lockdown. And the graph of change in real estate sentiment show a definite panic and dip to a level. There was a little moment of stagnancy after that. But the good news is that as soon as there was a relaxation in the lockdown, we observed a gradual increase in property searches on our portal. And this is increase in property searches across the city, with south markets being the most active one. This clearly indicates that we are on the path of recovery. And if we talk about the stock market also, the stock market is showing the similar kind of graph where the market has gone down in the month of March and April, but then gradually recovered to around 30%. So if we talk about the prices in the market, that how the prices have behaved in this particular period. So we did two studies separately. One study in the time of April, where the lockdown was just announced. And what we realized that the prices were declined 2 to 9% in April month itself. But at the same time, the moment the lockdown has relaxed, we in the April to June quarter, the prices decrease across the city was just 1.5% on a quarter on quarter basis. And if we talk about the YOY basis, that is year on year basis, there is still some green shoots. You can see 9 out of total 12 cities are still showing an increase in prices on a year on year basis. If we talk about different cities, then cities like Mumbai, cities like Kolkata, New Delhi, where the real estate activities were a little lower, and more, I would say, the stagnancy was there. The prices have come down around in the range of 0.4 to 2%, which is very minuscule if we see the impact of this COVID-19. Talking about the South market, which were very active during the COVID time, pre-COVID time, Hyderabad, Bangalore, and Chennai, they have observed around 2 to 5% decline. However, if you see year-on-year prices, the prices have shown green in Hyderabad and Chennai. However, Bangalore observed just 1.5% decline. So this was about the prices in the market. On the demand side, if I talk about the property buyer has already come back. If you see the graph, the recovery graph, it clearly indicates that the buyer has come back. Most of the searches are happening in the 2 to 3 BHK range. The price range, the most of the people are searching in the price range of 4,000 to 6,000 rupees a square. So that was about what has happened during the quarter in April.
Thanks, Surbhi. And that actually sets the context for why we chose to not do a pan-India discussion, but a South discussion, because the South is each part of the country seems to be behaving very differently, probably also looking at the virulence of the pandemic itself. The West and the North have been reeling under it much more than the South. And therefore, we thought that let's pick up the South first. I'm going to go to Suresh Hari. Suresh, if you look at what's happening in the Bangalore market, there is some kind of an interest from the consumer. And, you know, in normal times, 1-2%, we wouldn't even consider it a change, right? But today, because one, the markets have been stagnant for 5 years, more or less stagnant in various levels of stagnancy. And the second thing is that from a panic situation to a gradual upswing, the consumer sentiment is moving. So we checked. Now, also remember that Magic Bricks prices are actively traded property. It includes new property as well as second sale property. So it's an average of the two. So Suresh Hari, help us understand what your understanding of this consumer behavior is.
The consumer behavior is, I would say, is more buoyant than it was earlier, because they were more visiting the sites and doing physical than online activity. And now is the time Magic Book may be more accessed and similar approaches being looked into. If you see some of the report by the corporate who are giving their Q1 and Q2 performances, they all opine on the same principle that online activities have phenomenally increased, and that is taking care of. And the second thing we have to understand, this pandemic has caused a different type of a mindset among the consumers also. Today, the person who was looking at postponing his investment option to perhaps a year or two is now looking at more seriously. But only thing is, he is a fence sitter today, looking at, because various reports coming, the prices are going to crash, all that. Have you ever seen in the last 5 or 6 years prices coming down, be what it is? The ground, there is no demand. If there is no construction activity stopped, or there is a problem with construction activity also, we have gone through the phases, the cycle. Still, the prices have been so steady and so gradual increase, particularly Bangalore market, I can vouch. The rise is not phenomenal. It is year on year, if you take even, the rise is very gradual. It takes care of the actual cost that goes into it. Only price that has gone up is the cost of the land, the raw material for us. That is affecting us, I don't deny that. But that also, better prospects are coming in because government opening up the Land Reform Act and making us get more easy access to the land bank. So these are some of the actions that are taking place. And of course, you add that the phenomenon of stamp duty reduction, that is also enabling. We have certain incentives also we are looking at the government to look at. We are positive they are looking at it, because the government is on the one hand facing the pandemic. There is a terrible hospital-related issues and other things they need to address. It is not the industry alone they have to look at. But they have realized that lockdown is not the only solution for handling the situation. They realize lockdown is one of the methods to start with, but now we have to be more responsible. So having said that, you can forget there is going to be lockdown. So when you know it is not going to happen, people have to move around and set their target of pick up their stock needed, because today everybody wants to protect their family. That has become, many are today, you can see the software industry, many are on work from home. And a lot are coming back to Bangalore. I think the job opportunities in Bangalore is going to increase phenomenal now. So when that is so, the pick is going to be much better. If you see the drop of 1 or 2%, it may be a small correction on the resale. As you said, it's an average of various things. So we cannot really take it as the new product getting a price reduction. Perhaps the resale would have gone into some factor that has gone into it, or maybe one-off sale that has taken care of this reduction, because all are not the established builders, or some would like to exit. So such cases, the price reduction may be there, but I still feel like Madras and Hyderabad, or what you said, is in a positive. Bangalore also is on positive. We find a customer not coming asking us for price reduction. They are looking at spec reduction or spec changes. That is what they are looking at today. Maybe that will augment to us also in some cost cutting also. If you look at the end product, which has a different spec than what it was luxurious planned or a certain phenomenon that is not going to be much of more use for you now, maybe there is going to be a phenomenal reduction in the cost. That doesn't mean we have reduced the price. There's a cost input gone, and so there is a change in the price structure itself. This is what my analysis. The demand is there. The consumer behavior is much better. They are more comfortable doing online activity because they are much more safer. This, whatever you say, stepping out, people are worried about. So, and particularly those who are investing are more conscious of what they are doing around. And they are seeing a better time now.
I'm going to go to Rajendra Joshi. Who is the buyer today? What is that demographic and what is that age group who's buying today?
Okay. Bangalore, for one, has been largely an end user market. Unlike Mumbai, where I spent a large part of my real estate career, which used to be largely investor-driven, or Gurgaon, Bangalore has been an end-user market. And with the IT/ITES boom that has happened here, and fortunately, Bangalore actually has moved up the value chain on the IT/ITES. A lot of R&D centers, tech centers are coming into Bangalore. In fact, Bangalore is becoming the tech center hub for the world for many companies. Therefore, the age profile pre-COVID was coming down. People of the younger age category, those who were in their late 20s, early 30s, were getting into the buying mode. Post-lockdown, that has slightly altered. People, the age profile that we see has moved up a little bit because those who are in the younger category probably are a little unsure of their income. In fact, as Suresh rightly pointed out, the question today is not on whether the prices are coming down. What people are worried is, will their incomes be stable? Are there going to be salary cuts? Is there going to be a job loss? So those are the questions, and therefore, like in Brigade, we have taken measures to protect some of those. So in my view, the buyer even today continues to be predominantly IT/ITES in Bangalore. The age profile has certainly gone up post the lockdown, but the interest, as Suresh correctly pointed out, is there very much. April did see a huge drop. Our sales in Brigade, the sales came down to virtually about 15% of our last year average. We had a bumper year last year. We grew almost 50% plus last year, doing the best ever sales in the history of Brigade. But if you look at the last year's average, we were at 15% in April. By June, we have reached 60% of our last year run rate, correct? So it's been virtually a doubling of sales in each of the 3 months of the quarter. So buyer interest is definitely there. Today, they are a little unsure of their incomes, whether salary cuts will happen, how long all this pandemic will play out seems to be the question. But given the solid fundamentals in Bangalore, as Suresh correctly pointed out, the prices in Bangalore are a huge attraction. For the same level of income in Bombay, you can't even get a 1 BHK. Here, you can comfortably buy a 3 BHK if you wish to, for the same level of income that I'm saying. So given these, my view is that the buyer profile, though it has increased, I mean, the age profile has increased, but I think it will come back, and I don't see such a huge challenge unless there is a bigger disruption that happened. And Bangalore has also been fortunate that the effect of the corona, except for the last couple of weeks, was much, much muted in Bangalore in terms of number of infections and the people affected by it.
And Swarup, what has changed post-COVID in the mind of the consumer? When the consumer comes to the developer, what is he asking for that he didn't ask for pre-COVID?
I think the consumer is very sure of himself, and there's a certain positivity about home buying. There's a certain urgency to complete the transaction. Consumer knows very well that the market has been stable in terms of pricing and so on. And history has shown us that Bangalore, there's never been a rapid climb. I think it was well articulated by Mr. Hari. So consumer is very clear. The home has become the core. Everything else can wait. Any case, there's no overseas holiday. The car buying and all of that is now put on the side. The home receives the utmost priority, and there's a need to upgrade or complete that long pending home buy. All of that is there. There's also a distinct trend of getting into a large and organized community, because the amenities and the safety and the property management and all of that which you get surrounding a large community is unparalleled. So perhaps they had the first home purchased from the unorganized sector, and then now they want to upgrade, they want to move into a community which is well organized. I think just look at the market today. What is the home loan rate? It's come to an all-time low. It's like something like 6.95%. What's an FT rate? The home buying is the best option today, even as an investment. So we're seeing a mix of people who are putting their money into properties, of course, largely 80%, I would still say, actual home buyers, but that 20% is still significant. They're coming forward, they are investing, and there's a preference. If it's a ready property, they would like to wrap it up in a month's time, get moving, get into that home. And if it's a home that they desire to buy over the long term, absolutely no hesitation there as well. So we are seeing a sense of positivity across all sectors in Bangalore. It's not just the 50 lakh home or the 1 crore home. We've had significant transactions in the 2 and 3 crore budget, not to mention the higher tickets as well. As a matter of fact, in this month, we will be doing a launch too. So that's the confidence. We more or less restored our business to the February figures, which is fairly heartening, I must say. It's taken a lot of effort to restore business, but then things seem to be moving fairly smoothly.
I'm going to come back to that effort, hold that thought, because I want to see what developers are doing. But I'll go to Akshay. Akshay, Swaroop briefly spoke about two things that have come out. One is that it's a higher age group has also started entering the real estate market, and you see both new buys as well as upgrades. Help me understand, what is your view of the post-COVID buyer, and what is the sweet spot in this market? Or are there several sweet spots?
So just to repeat the sentiment.
Okay, I'm afraid we can't hear you.
I think that serious buyers are coming to the table. I don't think, is it now? Okay, can you hear me now? Is it good? Yeah.
Yes.
So I think the site visit numbers are not restored, I would say not restored as to what they were pre-COVID levels. But I feel the conversion ratios have increased quite a bit. So people who are actually coming to the site, their intent is more serious. They are actually looking to close out the deal. Earlier, we used to expect closures between 30 to around 30 days. I would say 20 to 30 days once the visits a site. And similar trend in terms of closure time the site to it closes the site. So I would say that
actually, could you repeat that last bit,
sorry,
please?
So I'm saying that earlier the closing cycle for a consumer used to be between 20 to 30 days. I see the similar cycle being maintained today also. I feel higher percentage of people who are coming to the site are buying an apartment today. I feel developers are not passing direct discounts, but there is some indirect discounting which is going on. I feel there are quite a few schemes which are going on in the market, which are pre-EMI in nature, or installments are more flexible, or there is a more refund, lenient sort of refund policy, which is there to secure the customer's mind. Because see, today the biggest challenge is, as it was pointed out by Mr. Joshi, that he's very scared about his job loss. He is uncertain about salary cut, and quite a few sectors we are facing these challenges, right? We have a lot of bookings. The other day, we were looking at a customer coming from Indigo, and then Indigo announced the cut. We were looking at some sectors which were coming in, then again, there was a salary cut. There has been some cancellations on account of job losses as well. So I think that what a consumer is looking as is a little more flexible cancellation policies in today's sale, where there's an easier exit clauses to move out in case things change. But I think the demand seems to be quite sustained. Even I would agree that we are almost back to the same Feb numbers which we were doing. I think we are back to similar numbers now in the coming months, in May. And I think we could actually cross those numbers in June.
Rohan, what does your data show you about the consumer? The age of the consumer, where he's searching for, which are the localities that you think there is enhanced consumer interest? And also, I would like you to address the budgets from your research.
So look, largely the point that Mr. Suresh has made, Rajendra, Sarup, Akshay as well, all points point to one very clear perspective, and that's that in the last 3 to 4 years as well, right? All these markets, despite you saying that they've had price increase, there has been a heightened level of affordability in the market. And that has not just happened because the price rise has been very consistent. It has been very runaway price rise. Developers have been very smart and strategic, right? They've offered you the right size of the apartment as well, right? They have not blatantly gone and launched a 4 BHK when they realize that the supply-demand dynamics don't match. So that affordability has gone up tremendously. Now, when you see that, obviously there is going to be better interest for buyers. Again, like the panel has mentioned earlier, the South cities, particularly Bangalore, has been pretty lucky with respect to the city opening up much earlier and being able to control the pandemic. So a lot of people who've come out in the market are obviously very serious buyers now. And these are people who know for sure that my job is secured, I have the finances to buy. And they are being smart that they are not overstretching their budget today, right? I have a certain budget in mind. I am not looking for aspirational today. I am looking for something that fits my budget, right? The other aspect is, interestingly also that we are seeing is younger guys, right? Younger people, younger couples who've been forced to work from home, right? They've suddenly realized that I really don't have a place to sit at home and work in, right? So maybe the renting bit is not really working out for me. And considering how your home loan rates are trending low in markets like Bangalore and the South markets, particularly if affordability is great, why not invest and go and buy a 2+1 BHK or a 3+study BHK, which allows me that advantage as well. Yeah. So all of this is playing into how the dynamic is also changing. While there are obviously some senior age people who are looking to buy and upgrade, because they're finding the market to be really, really conducive to buying today, it's the younger generation who's kind of driving this shift. Also, you will see that a lot of the launches that we have seen in the last 2-3 years across cities, including South City, they're very, very directed toward where your office corridors are or your growth corridors are. So effectively today, when we're talking of work from home or very short commutes to the workplace, all these projects tend to work really well. Right, all these are not very expensive, they are in the budget, they are offering the right kind of configuration. So you have buyers really going out. And so it's no surprise that conversion rates are actually higher. Because whoever is now venturing into the market is actually a very serious buyer who's intent on executing his purchase.
Yeah.
Right?
You want to pick up localities that you think are seeing enhanced interest?
If you ask me honestly, I would typically pick out all office corridors in Bangalore, right? Whitefield, your North Bangalore side, Sarjapur Road, right? Even locations like JP Nagar and all these places are also picking up. And again, it's primarily based on affordability and the fact that these are established office corridors. So, and I'm sure even other people will say the same, and the panel will also agree that you will see more traction in projects which are even in Chennai, for example, right? You see supply and demand both very targeted towards the OMR belt, right? Similarly, in Hyderabad, very much Western driven, where you have your Gachibowli and your high-tech city market. So it's very, very specific to that. And that's where actually, I think the traction also has actually been really high. So already there was a shift of buyers being closer to their workplaces. And I think this shift, this change now, of whether work from home or, flexibility in working, in office and home, this will drive buyers to actually look at such locations even closer, in a much closer manner. So and these locations have never been known to be premium locations. They are always in your budget, very well established, but well positioned in terms of budget as well.
So the buyer preference is also moving, is, you know, towards this corridor also, specifically for the south market. Yeah.
So Ruby, what are the kind of trends you're seeing in consumer searches on Magic Bricks? You've been looking at what the consumers are, how the consumers are looking. So what's new about the consumer trends?
As Rohan rightly said, that most of the demand, if I talk about locality perspective, most of the demand is focused towards the employment hubs. And especially people are looking for the affordable options. So, for example, in Bangalore, if we talk about Whitefield, Sarjapur Road, then you go to Electronic City, Bellary Road. These are the areas which are getting maximum traction. The people who are looking for a little more affordable, they are going a little ahead on these roads only. So the overall focus is that I need an affordable house. I need 2-3 BHK kind of apartment, which fits in my budget. And third thing is, it should be near to my workplace, right? Even though a lot of work from home is happening, but people are looking something like walk to work concept, so that they can have less commute, they can spend time with their family. So that is the one trend we have seen. Another trend that we have recently done a sentiment survey also during the time of April, during the time of pandemic. And then we are following another sentiment survey now in the coming July month, right? That what actually happened, how the sentiment has played. So what we realize that although people are looking for little budget cut, you know, a lot of people are really concerned about their jobs and all, and they are looking for budget cut, but at the same time, they are looking for smart houses. So probably they are looking that the space that developer is giving, that is well used, even if it is a smaller apartment. If they are using the space well, they are liking those kind of apartments. Even the amenities, they are choosing on the basis of what they actually need. So not the fancy amenities they are looking for. They are ready to compromise on that part because, you know, it's not an aspirational buyer buying right now. And a lot of people also understand during this pandemic, when they are spending the time at their home, that it is of utmost importance. You know, even I would say the rental market is also doing good. And it's nothing like that there was a panic in rental market or somebody was throwing you out of your house. But at the same time, a lot of people realize that home is something they have to buy. You know, even the lower age people group, when we were doing this survey, we talked to a lot of lower age millennial people especially. And I feel that job security was in their mind, but at the same time, the home ownership was also in their mind. So that is the trend here.
Rajendra Joshi, with this kind of demand, how different will the planning process be? Because clearly the kind of space that I had, say, pre-pandemic, where I used to come back from work and spend the time with my family and sleep, and the time that I spend working in my house as well. So it's a multi-layering the house. How different is the planning process? Do you think this will continue into the future, or it's just a temporary phenomenon?
Our sense is that work from home is a reality. People have figured out that you can have a certain percentage of your team or the organization work from home. May not be on all days, but at least a few days of the week. So what we are also seeing is that, therefore, a place where you can work, a small study, etc., in my view, will become more important as we go ahead in our planning cycle. However, as everyone else has been talking about, we will have to keep affordability in mind, because ultimately, as it has shown in the last few years, it is the ticket size which determines your sales velocity. But therefore, as Surabhi rightly pointed out, the smart planning of spaces, ensuring that while you have bedroom, do you compromise a little on the living space to give maybe a small study space, etc., I think will become important from the internal perspective. From the external perspective, we strongly believe that complexes or developments where you have amenities like a small shop, a creche, these kind of things will become more important, because in case something happens, we have seen that the larger developments where there were things which were available within the complex, people had a much easier life compared to smaller standalone buildings where people had to go out or we're dependent on going out. I think from that perspective, I think it also will, people will look at being getting into larger gated communities, and Bangalore has many such from Brigade, Prestige, Shobai. All of us have built large, good gated communities. So I think from these perspective, both would become important. The space within your house, how smartly do you need, do you plan it, and a space for you to work and maybe your spouse to work. There are many people where you need, both of us, you need to work at the same time. And the amenities which are there, which are functional amenities. I think Surabhi pointed out that rightly, that it is not necessarily the spa and those kind of things, but the functional amenities. I think both will become important as we go along.
Akshay, when you're Akshay, can you hear us? I think Akshay's screen has frozen. Swarup, I'll come to you to change this planning process to deliver more within the space that you have. Would you need any policy push? Do you think that the government can do something to help you guys?
I think fundamentally there's always scope. That I would say is the number one premise, and I think we should, as developers, push architects to come up with better solutions. Sometimes we may also need to combine this with smart interior solutions as well, because there's a limit to how much I can push this, the overall outlay or the budget or the overall sizing. It's important to enable certain spaces for work, yes. No doubt about it. And if you can come up with, like I said, furniture solutions to back it up, fabulous. The home size will necessarily go up a bit. That is absolutely essential. So in terms of budget, we can't have a 20% rise because you're trying to accommodate some office space. Perhaps a 5 to 10% would be something a buyer would consider, you know, putting out additional. Having said that, in terms of government, I would only say taxation is huge in our business. It's unbelievably high. The developer picks up the entire 18% GST, though proudly people say it's only 5% for the consumer. Just add up all the taxes. The consumer is paying a hell of a lot in terms of taxes, levies, and stamp duty. So I'd say, why compromise his home any further? I think we should allow the taxation regime to open up a little bit to enable him, you know, to buy a slightly larger home at almost the same price. I think that's what we should aim to achieve.
Akshay, I'm going to take that thought one step further and say that today, if you have to deliver to the consumer and the consumer to think of slightly different home, there are many houses that were on the drawing board. Do you think that you will start relooking at the consumer demand? And will you see changes happening to projects that you haven't yet launched?
So, you know, I think that it's not because of the pandemic. There will be I think there could be a change in the master plan to suit requirements, as Rajendra said, about people working from home and whether they are equipped to sort of have working spaces in the community. There are more suitable changes which promotes more of a work from home life. But from a home perspective, I think it all depends on the affordability in that particular area, what kind of size is more suitable from a sales perspective. I think that will still continue the same way it is going. The designs have to be more efficient. If you can create a working nook, probably it will be appreciated during these times because it's valued. But otherwise, I don't see a major change, you know, happening in terms of design of a unit itself. Nonetheless, I feel that the three-bedroom demands have been quite robust during this time. I've seen three bedrooms as being the most preferred unit type. And I think that one bedroom is slowly slipping below the 1,000 square feet range. And that's where the demand picks up in a one bedroom. But more or less, a consumer is looking out for a more compact or 1150, 1200 square feet three bedroom. So I guess it's coming more from a utility perspective. And even now, if they can spare that extra one bedroom in their apartment, I think that that sort of promotes the demand. So I'm seeing a little bit of a shift. but it's not a major shift. I think it was the same, much the same before. So I would say that change in the master plan today, developers taking cognizance of the fact that a lot of time is being spent at home, how the family splits and who all are working and how many people are staying at home. I think the master plan will be viewed in a little different light today.
Rohan, connectivity is going to be a major issue. All of you have talked about how people don't want to travel too much. If you travel, either it's walk to work or drive a short distance to work. So that's, the metro, the connectivity, the new infrastructure that's coming, will that drive residential demand?
No, honestly, if you ask me, I think that has always driven residential demand. Always we have found that corridors where connectivity has been better, they've always done well. In fact, most of the corridors where connectivity never really developed beyond the drawing board, they became speculative corridors and then the growth kind of stopped, right? That will become essential. And even now, when the entire panel agrees to the fact that, it's very employment hub driven, those hubs are already well established, well connected. That's why they have developed as employment hubs. So effectively speaking, you will need connectivity to be a major driver. Even otherwise, we have seen and proven through different aspects and different time frames. Whenever you announce a new project, announce a new infra project, for example, a connectivity project, a corridor tends to speculatively pick a lot of momentum in terms of growth, right? And when that project is nearing closure, most of the appreciation in prices already happened. But the moment that project you realize is not, going beyond the drawing board or is not really completing, there's also a sudden dip in interest and prices tend to stagnate. So connect and I think buyers have become really smart now, right? You can't keep selling them, potentially futuristic locations now. They want to be in a location which they know today has good connectivity. I don't want to be, swayed by a 5-year plan for a location. I want to look at what the location has developed at this point in time. And I think most of us are also seeing that in terms of the demand that we see is either ready to, if it's not ready to move in, it's also short duration demand in the sense that I want to move into an apartment in the next 12 to 18 month period, not more beyond that, right? So all that is largely driven by connectivity because not just connectivity, but even the amenities in that region, the social infrastructure, right? I want to be in a self-contained ecosystem, right? I would prefer that I don't travel beyond that location for my work as well. But if I have to, I would want a shorter commute either way, right? But from an ecosystem perspective, I want something that's really, really self-contained from a living quality perspective. That's very important. So connectivity obviously plays a huge role in that.
Surbhi, lots of people have spoken about the ready to move in the 12 to 18 months from completion houses. What does PropIndex show? Do you help us understand what the site is showing in terms of searches? I can't hear you, Surbhi, you're on mute.
So definitely, Jayashree, when we did our sentiment survey, it is showing a very huge tendency towards ready-to-move-in properties. People want to have a certain kind of surety that I am going to get my apartment. And the beauty about the market right now is that there is a lot of inventory available in ready-to-move segment. Because in last 4 or 5 years, the number of launches have reduced. A lot of developers or most of the developers are focusing on completing the projects. So there is a lot of inventory in that segment where either they are ready to move or they are going to be ready in 3 to 6 months or 6 to 1 year. So most of the people, I would say, especially in a mature market like Mumbai and New Delhi, most of the market are looking for these ready properties. Also, there is a very less difference of prices between ready to move and under construction projects. So it also makes sense to buy a ready property, looking at the delays in the projects. So that is one thing. Another thing is the south markets, they are less prone to delays. That is a good thing about south market, that they are a little less prone. The developers are more professional in south markets. So there, the demand for under construction is also there. And that's why whatever launches we saw in this pandemic period was in south markets only.
Absolutely. Rajendra, when we look at amenities, you did refer to it briefly. Will you see a change in the kind of amenities that developers like you will offer because will saunas, jacuzzis, swimming pools become redundant in favor of maybe a workstation or a small workplace within the complex?
Okay. I don't think all of them, the luxury amenities, like the swimming pool, the saunas, will go out of the window. Some, yes. For example, when we are now doing planning for some of our larger projects, we are certainly bringing in workstations.
Yeah.
We think a small business center makes sense, given what is happening now. And also, the trend that a lot of people today at the age of 40, 45, 50 want to get out of the active corporate life and want to do their own consultancy or their own business, etc. So that's one thing which is coming in. The second thing we are actively putting in all the places is a pharmacy, a clinic, apart from a convenience store, a pharmacy and a clinic, which is what we are looking at. So it may eat up some space of your saunas, spas, etc. A swimming pool, despite personally, I'm not a big fan of a swimming pool, but it's a must amenity everywhere. From an usage perspective, you go and see any swimming pool, the number of people that you use a swimming pool versus the money that you spend on maintaining a swimming pool just doesn't match. But everyone wants a swimming pool in their complex, so we build it. I did try that once in Bombay when I was in Mahindra, and everyone said, no, you can't do this. And finally, we had to bring back the swimming pool. So that's the reality today. But yes, we are. Therefore, there is a change in planning. Some of these things, as Rohan did mention, people are looking at more self-contained. So if I have to work, not just in this pandemic situation, but I decide to move on and get out of active corporate life or active whatever work life that you're doing, do I have a workspace? Do I have a clinic and pharmacy, ATM, etc.? So all these are becoming important. As I said, Bangalore has always been fortunate in that the cost of land is not sky high like in Bombay, and therefore the larger communities have always had some of these spaces, but I think that focus is coming more on these kind of amenities than just the lifestyle amenities.
Akshay, in places that have been driven by the metro march, you know, places near the metro always had seen a 10 to 25% rise over a period of time. Do you think with the reluctance to travel in public transport right now, that may get impacted?
So, you know, I don't think that so much of a shift will happen due to the metro or non-metro. It's too soon to sort of say that, people started to assume that metro travel will impact the pricing of a particular locality or the demand of that locality will go or not. See, one has to note that if there is a metro, means that itself is a reasonably established neighborhood, irrespective of the metro being there or not. So it'll generally follow the guidance of the neighborhood, the stock and inventory situation in that neighborhood, how much competition or the past guideline of prices that has been. Metro, I would say, was a good sales converter. I would not necessarily say it was a price appreciator. In general, but it was a good sales converter.
Will it remain a good sales converter?
Yeah, I think so. I don't think people have given up hope. They are buying apartments. The sales as have been, everybody seeing a pre-COVID level sale turnout. That means the hope is still alive. I don't think people have thought that the world is ending or anything like that. I think they assume that in 6 months we'll go back to being normal. And they'll start going using the metro back again. I don't think they're factored that metro will not be the use of transport.
Swarup, help me understand the luxury market. What is the luxury demand today? Some of you briefly referred to it. 1 crore above, 2 crores and above. Do you see that market doing well? Because, and if so, is it first time buyers or upgrade buyers?
Let me first tell you that the numbers are limited. Right? Now, having said that, there's not much of a choice in Bangalore if you really want it. You'd find the number of properties on offer can't be more than about 20 or 25 in the so-called luxury market. The luxury home buyer is actually looking at an upgrade. He's absolutely clear that he wants a larger space or a newer property or better amenities or whatever. There's also a significant number of capital gains cases where the person has to put aside a certain amount of money, and the real estate solution is a good tax shield for that. So that's been happening. But I must tell you that there is overseas demand for high ticket properties quite significantly. And there's also a demand from people who are living in certain unorganized communities, etc., wanting to buy. Now, these buyers, I would say, are from the age 45 onwards, largely seen to 60, up to 60 or 65. So, and we've had transactions in the 20 crore range, the 25 crore range as well. But that's not where we are really in as far as our business is concerned. We are largely in the sub 5 to 10 kind of range, where customers look forward to a ready property. If there's an option, they'd like to pay up, move in within the month. That's what we've been seeing in the recent past.
Rohan, finally, is the investor going to come back in, or will this market be dominated by end users for some more time?
Look, I don't think the South markets were ever really driven by investors. They were always very, very end user driven. I think just the whole panel agrees to the fact that there've never been runaway price rises in these markets. Very sustainable, and that's a hallmark of a end user driven market. Right. So till the time that fundamental remains, I honestly don't see why you need investors in that market, unless you want a speculation to come back. Other than that, people, investors, look, strategic investors will always be there in the market. It's not that they will not be there, right? Even today, Anish mentioned, Swaroop mentioned earlier as well, there are certain strategic buyers who are looking at the luxury segment as well. They think it's a great time to invest because probably I'll not get a better deal than this time. Let me have it. Let me keep it somewhere, right? So you will always have such players in the market always. The quantum of investor that you had in markets like Delhi and Bombay, you know, in the peak market was unprecedented. You will not probably see them come back because a lot of them have burned their fingers. And honestly, now markets are also a little more traditional in terms of how prices are growing. So people expecting those kind of, you know, super normal kind of returns, I mean, those expectations will not come true.
Yeah.
But strategically, if you have a long-term vision and you realize that there will always be capital appreciation on a physical asset like real estate and residential real estate, so to speak, right? Those investors will always come back. So long-term vision investors will definitely, I think they are still there in the market. Okay. They've been a little careful in where to invest, but they've been there. The speculators, so to speak, are not there. Okay. So those investors, now you will see also, this is like a great time for them, right? And getting great deal at this point in time, they will be more than happy to put money. But the quantum obviously won't be as much, but they will definitely consider projects. And you see all of them, right? Right from film stars to industrialists to all these guys, right? They are actually very actively, and we know from our residential sales team as well, right? Very actively scouting for, you know, great deals in the market, right? So that smart investor will never exit the market, so to speak, really.
And Jayshree, I'll just add here quickly that so-called luxury property is all operating on historical cost. Mm-hmm. If I were to replicate any of those properties today, those prices would be significantly higher. And the buyer in the market fully understands that. So what was available in the luxury side, it's an absolute bargain. And, those who are, conscious of the timing, etc., will make those decisions and move forward. And on the other side, in terms of long-term investment on the property side, look at the options. I mean, if you were a FD operator, so to speak, you put your money into an FD, and then what is it that you're earning? Taxes all eaten away. Whereas the home gives you that shield. I mean, let the property appreciate over a period of time. You're not paying any taxes for the gains till you actually transact that property. So we're finding a lot of people.
How long should you hold? If I'm a strategic investor, how long should I hold in the?
I would say run it through the tenure of the project, 3 years.
Okay. Surbhi, I'm going to, this is the last leg of the conversation. What do we need in terms of policy? There is a lot of talk about finance, about capital adequacy, about making capital available, last mile funding, and so on. So in addition to which, you are going to see execution of projects, the infrastructure projects that have been announced. So Surbhi, very quickly, two policy changes that you think have been good or should be done in the southern markets.
I think from the policy perspective, I think the execution on ground is most important, because we have a lot of announcement, a lot of planning is already there on the drawing board. So probably we need execution of those projects, and definitely those market, those corridors, which are actually waiting to just complete some stretches of road or, you know, some kind of amenities they are looking for. If they get completed, definitely those market will pick up. So that is one thing from the policy perspective. The second thing, I think the way metro is growing in all the cities, I think it's a high time that we are completing those projects on time, right? And definitely that will help a lot of buyers, because they most of the time buy in the expectation that the metro will come to that particular area, or the roads will be constructed at a certain given point of time. I think that kind of trust we have to give to the from the government side. You know, we generally talk about developer trust, but I think that trust that infrastructure will be completed in that particular site, developer is also looking for, and the buyer is also looking for right now.
And Bangalore is a critical city which has been struggling with governance issues, right? Okay, I'm going to, there's a comment that has come from Umesh Dudwani, who says it's contradictory. There's a liquidity crunch in the market. How does it support the demand? Okay, Rajendra, let's talk about the finance position. Is the industry under financial stress? Do you need the government to ease up a little?
The answer is in two parts. One, the developers who have had good financials, and Bangalore has many of them. Bangalore probably has the best quality of developers that one sees. I think they are all good. They're doing well. They don't need. But in certain cities and in certain developers where there is a financial stress, definitely there is a need, and government has announced a policy and a fund to complete the projects which have been stuck, correct? So I think that certainly would help. In terms of the developers' own financing, the whole COVID is going to put pressure from one perspective, that the slower sales which happened in the first couple of months, and many of us have done a lot of easy payment plans, etc. So this is going to put pressure on our cash flows in the near term. That's the second that I see. From government perspective, if you ask me, more than liquidity, I would echo what Swaroop actually said, is that this sector has tremendous amount of taxation. The withdrawal of input tax credit, which happened effective 1/4/2019, has increased the prices at least by 10 to 12%, correct? Because that whole burden has shifted to the consumer. So I think this is where government should look at and make it a lot more flexible and end of the day consumer friendly. As he correctly pointed out, if the prices are 10% lower, you can buy a space which is 10% larger. So I think this is where government needs to look at and not just think that developers are making supernormal profits. They are not. None of the developers today are making supernormal profits. Gone are those days. So we need to treat it like a industry, look at what the issues on taxation, on the circle rates or the guideline values, etc. I think a lot of these would certainly help. Financing is one bit. But Bangalore, to my mind, isn't as affected as other cities are on that bit.
Okay. Suresh Hari, how are you going to the government? What are the changes that you are demanding? I'm sorry, I forgot to include you in the last round.
No. They are market, and you had the best of the answer possible. That's good. They gave from the perspective they are in the pain point and the value chain they are in. Now, coming to the government level of action, our demands are always there. We understand the government as limitation. But you know, you saw the same government when the pandemic of this sort came into force, they opened up their purses also to a greater extent on very many fronts, which is unbelievable. Perhaps India is one of the few countries in the world which did that. Too much of pumping in resources and various other schemes. I think we should appreciate the government. And in this process, I tell you, there is one question you asked earlier about the pandemic, if this is going to continue. If this is going to continue forever, I think the mankind is for a heading different. I will get into an industry pay making PPE kits, because that would be the best selling option for me. I don't think that is going to be a end of all. And we know, every single soul knows that this is a passe. This too shall pass. So having said that, everybody clearly said, what are the reset we are going to do? When we are doing reset, including there was an angle of taxation that was spoken about. That is very important to understand. Government has to understand. In fact, we had a couple of demands. One is on stamp duty reduction. We said, make out a specific at least 3 months, 4 months, where a concessional duty. That would have created a phenomenal. One is the government is a win-win situation then. One is the registration, they get the stamp duty in, which is the biggest revenue stream into the government. Second, the sentiment of consumer who feels that the stamp duty, this reduction across the board, not on 35 lakh ceiling, because where do you get in Bangalore 35 lakh property? It has no value chain for us. But if you make it across the board, say that any property you are going to register in the next 3 months, 4 months, you will get a concessional tariff of 4%, something. What a phenomenal hit that would be. I think there is, I saw in the research, Surabhi has done a phenomenal job. I saw the demand supply gap is there, yeah, on certain segment. So these things, you know, will change. The phase of these demand gap also will change. People who are not, the affordability will come in if the taxation come down. In no way the developer can reduce the price, because the cost has gone in. Already taken a beating. The wealth of the universe has not gone anywhere. It is only stuck somewhere. It is not that pandemic has removed this and throw out of the universe. No. It is there in some form or other. So we need to realign this, bringing in more of transparent and a workable model for everybody. Win-win for all. We have gone through phases. The real estate has taken a beating, I can say, in the last 4 or 5 years. And it gradually is coming out. In fact, 2020, when we started at the end, 19, it was looking beautiful. We were looking at a kickstart, and some of our expos were so well received. We thought, no, the happy days are here again. And we still believe we are the one, you know, when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. We are the toughest breed on earth. The real estate faces so much of challenges. We are the tough hide to withstand any thing. But at the same time, we need a helping hand. The government has to look at stamp duty reduction. Look at various taxes that go into, including our plant sanction, to the conversions, to various processes. We have done analysis now. The latest we have to redo it. It is almost 20 to 24% is the taxation that any buyer gives to the government in one form or other when he buys the property. Is it not a phenomenon? One place we are treated as a commodity, sales tax or a GST is there. One place we are a revenue where the stamp duty comes into place. Then transfer of property, then the various other, everywhere it is taxed. We have to look at it, roti, kapda, makan, if they are essential. In what way makan is inferior to roti and kapda? Roti and kapda, somewhere you'll get. Makan, you can't get it somewhere. We have to make it. We are the wealth creators. If we don't have that support, the industry will keep on working its mechanism, but it will take time. We need a governmental action to look into the stamp duty reduction, taxes input reduction. GST on 18% is too high. The GST rates have to come down drastically. Come down. Circle rates, you know, when the going was good, we used to tell circle rate is only a guiding principle for various parameters. It should not be a system to decide on the taxation or the stamp duty purpose. Circle rate should be for the purpose of assessment or hiding of income. Those are the factors that will come into, not for the purpose of your fixing the taxes. If a neighbor sells a higher price, I also get affected. If neighbor sells a lower price, they don't reduce it. They look at my price. So it is one way it is good, one way it is not good. So the problem is we should delink all this. The factors should be more market driven. Across the globe, these are not the phenomenon that is being put in place. Real estate should be viewed differently. After RERA has come into place, the industry is in a much, much different footing. Most of the fear of a customer is not there now, including RERA authorities have shifted the sanction and the process by a reset of our process. So that is helping us. So similar approach is what is needed. Customer is the king today, really. They demand what they want, and we have to give what they want. And it is nice and heartening to see that when you spoke about Bangalore builders being more responsible and especially South builders, I agree on that. It's not that other places are not. It is perhaps the ground realities are different. Here, perhaps we have a good understanding of the government and the industry interface, where we are also trying to be more transparent possible, giving better facilities and better options for the customer. But I think the mindset of the customers, the today's generation, is on a big change. This mindset is not going to change for a long time. Whatever the pandemic goes, or you have a vaccine coming in, you have some medicine treatment coming in, whatever it is, the mindset one has come, you know, it takes generation for it to get out of it. And we need developers know about it. We are like, you know, we change fast. Anything we can alter. You think a design element which is gone in, we have beautiful design element possible, alteration possible to take care of the current situation. We'll weather all these things. We'll go through the challenges, but we need more of governmental support. We knock at their door continuously. We look at how fast they can give our sanctions. Sanctions are very important for us. You take the environmental clearances, which was not there earlier for at least residential, which is not there. The lakes are the waterfront issue, which came as a big challenge for us. We went to the Supreme Court and got the relief. But still, the CDP has to change, the master plan has to change. All these have to evolve themselves. We have to be in the fast track of all these things. So once all these are in place, the government understands. Let us see how we are able to push through this point. The industry works on the association, works on addressing these concerns more than anything else. We are on that page. I wish all of you all the best. I'm sure it is going to be a good 2020 from now on. Let us see the pandemic goes and we have a better time ahead.
Akshay, I'm going to come to you. Is the cost of compliance, the various compliances, going to increase? Is it very high?
It is truly high. So it just keeps on changing with the government shifting. And but I would say that the cost of compliance in the last 5 years have risen slowly but surely. I think also the cost of JD registration, which was pretty reasonable at one point of time, has added a huge cost upfront, which was not the cost in Bangalore. Actually, Bangalore used to be very efficient in terms of JD registrations. 15 lakhs was the cap. And now even you register a 4 or 5 acre property, you're paying around 3-4 crores depending on the circle rate as registration charges. That's a leakage up front. Approvals, earlier we used to estimate a reasonable amount. It's just gone up, I think, around close to 25-30% from what it used to be maybe 2 years ago. Cost of sanctions, getting electricity per unit, it depends on the regime. It keeps on fluctuating from time to time as to what finally it is. So overall, to sum up, I feel that the cost of doing business from a regulator point of view is high in Bangalore.
Swarup, is RERA a boon or a bane for you? How has RERA impacted the way you do business?
I'd say RERA makes the entire community, you know, on a level playing field. There's no question of going to the market before you get all your approvals. Everybody understands the delivery periods and all of that are very, very clear. I'd say even within the organizations, the word RERA has resonated from the salesperson to customer relations to finance to engineering and to management. Everybody's aligned to falling in line, right? So this is the significant change which has happened. And of course, I'd say RERA and Bangalore, things are very good. I think they proactively look at issues. The entire setup there is really good. And I'd say it gives huge amount of comfort to the consumer. And that's what we need. Despite whatever was said in the past, There were very many non-complying developers or promoters, they are simply not in the market anymore. So that's what RERA has done to us, and they will improve their systems from time to time. And I think it's a great development.
Rohan, one
just
last
question. To add to what Sani said, I think the entire reporting structure is on RERA internally now. So it's sort of T plus RERA is how it is reported. Are we safe? Are we within the RERA timeline? Are we not within the RERA timeline? Or how things are progressing as per the RERA timeline? So I guess the reporting structure internally has changed. But it's a really good thing, I feel, for the industry in a way to have RERA.
Rohan, one final question. Comes from Sonali Sridhar. She's a consumer who asks, are home buyers turning towards plotted development as they have more control over the design layout of their home? Rohan, what is your view on that?
Look, I think it's a very mixed strategy. It's not just consumers. I think even some developers are looking at it, right? Honestly, the turnaround is faster. You have, as a consumer, you have control. For a developer as well, you just sell a service plot, right? So for him also, the turnaround tends to be very fast, right? So from that perspective, there will be a focus on plotted development. It's not possible to do it everywhere, right? You will only do it in locations where land, you get that size of land where you can cut plots out and sell service plots. But yes, there is a change to it. And I think there's nothing wrong with it. I mean, in the sense that the market is evolving, right? In this market, if you're finding that cash flow timelines are longer for condominium, then I can make do with faster cash turnaround times with doing a plotted development. Why not? Right? So it's a win-win for both, honestly speaking, right? And like I said, right, RERA timelines really don't matter too much because you're selling a service plot, right? And good turnaround, so why not? It's a good thing to look at. But again, you know, all other caveats need to be in line, right? Locations, connectivity, right? What are the amenities, the support infrastructure that will be provided to you? That remains critical always in any residential bank decision, whether it's an apartment or a plot.
I'm going to end this conversation with a response to Mr. K. N. Kumar. He wrote to us on Facebook where he says, everything the government has to do, what is the builder's role? They don't want to reduce huge profit margins and won't reduce price despite huge inventory. We always have these rants, but I would like to address this. Mr. K. N. Kumar, the important thing that came out of this conversation is that there is a RERA. For the developer, for the consumer, the developer, Akshay said, it's T plus RERA. Similarly, for you also, you need to understand that the RERA is also there as a support structure for you. The second thing, there are many things that are not in, was not in people's control in terms of very long timelines for approvals and so on. We are seeing some of these being addressed, and many of these will take away the pain that you feel. And I'm not negating the pain that many home buyers felt. The third thing, and this is something that we at Magic Bricks have been telling you, look at the track record of the developer you're going with. There are many, many, many developers, and this whole lineup sitting here are people who have a track record of delivery. You have to go back and do your homework as a consumer if you want to avoid this pain. But does that mean that prices can be today drop or plummet or something like that? I don't think so. The reality on the ground is, I mean, many bankers, many government officials said drop prices. But could developers drop prices? Did developers drop prices? And has the consumer stopped buying? I don't think so. So I think somewhere we have to maintain that balance. You as a potential buyer has to take the responsibility of the research, and developers like them have to take the responsibility of delivering what they've promised and delivering on time. Yes, Suresh Hari, you have something.
Our friend Kumar had an interesting quotation to put that he said, excess profit. I don't know where they get this thought. See, we are the industry which are in direct relation with the end buyer. Let us be clear about it. Take any other industry, a car manufacturer. A car manufacturer doesn't come. There's a dealer who goes around sell the car. A tire manufacturer, he doesn't even know who is the manufacturer of the tire. So in our case, every single element that goes into a building is in direct connection with our customer. there is a cost involved in our investment, the cost involved. I cannot show a face of haggard look to show to my customer because the face is the index of the mind. If I show a pampered look, my customer is going to feel more haggard than coming near me. There are many a times you put up a face that is so rosy that they don't understand the pain point the builder is going through. They all think, you know, we are having enough. So it is a misnomer. The cost, many have a thumb rule indexation, working of cost, your cement is so much, your steel is so much, cost of construction 2,500, take it. They miss out on the various FIR issues, the local issues, the licensing issues, the connection issues, the finishing issues, the handover issues, and particularly the management issues. So there are a lot of cost, hidden cost that goes into a development, and many a time what you see is not what you are seeing actually on the face of a developer. There are many pain points within him, but still they try to deliver what the customer wants. I think there is a little misnomer. This has to be understood. Because can you value the product that I give? You buy a t-shirt, the same shirt, maybe 500. On a platform, it sells 100. Can you compare them both? They both serve the same purpose. So we need to be very sensitive on when you do a product, what is the value that has gone into the product?
Akshay, I think you wanted to say something and then we'll close this.
No, actually, it's a very simple math. I think Bangalore is a very streamlined market. The land prices, the average mean price here is around 5,500 rupees. The land prices and FAR cost, whether you do it a JD or you buy, ranges between 15% to 20%. Your input cost is around 60% to 65%. You're left with a 15% to 20% margin depending on whether you are writing off land as a cost or not. So when we launch the project, even those margins are lower. This 15-20% is only when we achieve the average price across the life of the project. So I would say that would be typically the margin a real estate project, of which 5-6% here and there discounting has happening due to various scenarios and downturns and stuff like that. So I think that if there is any more correction in real estate from where at least the banker pricing stands, I think there'll be a zero margin for a real estate developer doing business. We are actually depending on these pricing to escalate over the life of the project to actually achieve a mean price. And as you started this discussion, you showed that there has been a 0% escalation in Bangalore pricing. You know that the pricing has been the same, which kind of shows that what margins a real estate developer is actually working at. In fact, the real estate pricing has been similar in the last 3 to 4 years versus the construction price has risen year on by 6%. So actually a thing which 4 years back, 1800 was the reality, 1850 for a pure construction cost is nothing less than 2250 to 2350 today. So that is a 500 rupee jump in terms of construction versus the sales price have not jumped that much. So I think it's a misconception that real estate has high margins or is a very highly profitable business in some sorts.
When the price don't rise year on year, indexed to inflation, it is actually a drop in prices because correct. The inflation doesn't stop.
Absolutely.
So as consumers, you have to understand that pre-RERA, there were a lot of problems. But slowly, the RERA has been bringing a lot of conforming to rules, norms. The non-serious players are being weeded out. And you are seeing a cleanup in the market. Of course, it takes time because legacy issues have to be sorted out. But I think the conversation today was more about how are the markets responding? How are the developers responding? And what is the future of the market? Thank you so much for joining the Property Show.
Thank you. Thank you.